Welcome to Overcoming Testimonies, brought to you by Eden Mesganaw of Remax Premier and ObeyEthiopianDishes.com, where God's greatness is your testimony. Now, here's your hosts, Pastor Yonatan and Eden Mesganaw.
Good evening, our WDCX family, and Happy New Year. This is Eden Mesganaw, together with Pastor Yonatan, your hosts, for Overcoming Testimonies. I'm going to read our team scripture to get us into today's program. That's found at Revelation chapter 12, verses 11. And it reads, "And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. And they loved not their lives unto the death." That's what the word of God said. Let's quickly pray. Holy Spirit, we invite you. God, the Father, Jesus Christ, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we thank you so much for giving us 2018, for us to have passed through to come and see 2019. We bless your holy name. Mm-hmm. So Lord, as Pastor Yonatan shares his testimony today, take the glory. Take the honor. In Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
So Pastor Yonatan, are you ready to testify today?
Yes, I am.
That's wonderful. Just to do a quick recap of in the past two sessions, what God has brought you through. First of all, you had to leave Ethiopia through religious persecution. Mm-hmm. Like in a sense, you're a teenager, like 16 turning to 17. Yes. And the way you decided to go to Sudan was walking by your feet, correct?
Yes.
And when you arrived at the border, you had food poisoning with your friend. Mm. Unfortunately, he didn't make it. He passed on.
Exactly.
But you were very close to death when the Sudan government that refused to let anybody in, but allowed you to be carried.
Yes.
To make it to the UN border.
Exactly. So that UNHCR, a center for UNHCR.
Yeah.
Where there was a clinic.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah. So that happened. And while you were put in a hut, you know, a little place made from dirt.
Yes.
Like between death and life, probably they thought you were contagious.
Yeah,
so they kind of separate you. God sent in his Bible. And also, I forgot the prayer you did at the border.
Yes.
You said, "God, I don't care if I die because I know I'm going to see you."
Exactly.
However, for my mom's sake, you know, if you ever allow me to leave, I will leave the rest of my life for you.
Exactly.
That was a commitment you made with God. So he started doing his work.
Mm.
He provided the Bible for you in that hut all by yourself.
Yes.
And then when that's all done, you're so starved, hungry.
Yes.
2 days, no food. And you told yourself, "I'm not going to beg. I'm the child of God. God, you got to provide."
Yes.
And to this day, we don't know whether it was a human being or an angel who fed you.
Exactly.
In the best place, the best food.
Yes.
And then he was departed.
Exactly.
You don't even know where he's gone.
That's right.
And then you start, you know, doing God's work. And before you know it, you're stuttered. Like you had a challenge of stuttering from a
from my childhood. Yes.
And God healed you. It was gone.
Exactly.
Preparing you for his work.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, God is awesome. And I guess you stopped off as you were trying your very best to leave Sudan and be able to move to Europe, United States, or, you know, North America.
Yes.
That was like where we kind of, I guess, stopped. Mm-hmm. Can you take it from there, please, Pastor?
Absolutely. Yes, yes. I will. Thank you. That was a very good reminder. And, you know, you just give me a good bridge to continue my testimony.
Mm-hmm.
You know, as I always say, our testimonies are God's stories. You know, if God is in them, they are God's story. They belong to God because they are for his glory. So I can surely say that God was in everything that I was going through, you know, through all my weaknesses, up and downs. Ups and downs, you know, I have seen God's hand in my life. And as you say, a life of refugee in third world, especially in the Sudan in those days, was really, really tough. So I was trying to survive every day. Every day gone by was not really easy. You know, you keep on trying. You know, try to survive, and as much as you try to survive, you try to help other refugees that, you know, come along, and so on. So that was really tough. But in all the dark days in Sudan, once you survive the toughest beginning time of your refugee life, then you come to a place where it's a little safer, you know. And I prayed. My family was helping me financially, but then I felt so bad, you know. Just imagine, I was 17 at that time. I turned 17 and turning 18. Getting some financial support from your parents still at that age as a refugee, I felt so bad, and I started praying, you know, Lord, you are my provider, and I really don't want, I didn't want to feel bad about, you know, just getting some money sent from my parents. And I said, you know, I was praying, Lord, open door for me, you know, I want to work, and I want to support myself. And then I kept on praying that prayer, and suddenly the Lord opened the door. You know, the Lord answered my prayer, and it was really amazing. I was hired by the American Embassy in Khartoum at that time. At that point in time, I joined a church, a refugee, Ethiopian refugee church, and I was serving the Lord in that church. I was a worship leader, and I was a Bible study, a cell group leader as well. And life was really, spiritually, I was thriving. I mean, I was growing in my spiritual life and so on. With a sense of a very strong Christian community, it was really, life was really a blessing, you know, in spite of the situation, the life of a refugee in a big, third world city, Khartoum. And then I was working as a dishwasher in the American Embassy restaurant for the diplomats and the workers there. And then working as a dishwasher at the restaurant, the American Embassy restaurant, I the Lord opened the door, you know, one step after another. I was after working as a dishwasher for a few months, I was promoted as a short order cook, and then after another 4 or 5 months, I was promoted to be an assistant cook, and then between 6 and 8 months, I was offered a job as a chef in the American Embassy. I was young and very ambitious, and I used to borrow some cookbooks from the embassy, and I would just go through it, read and learn and stuff. And I think it was just the Lord just blessing me, I became a chef at the American Embassy within just about a year and a half. I became a chef, and I was working there, supporting myself, and I was comfortable, and I was self-supporting, and I was even a blessing to other people that were suffering as refugees in Khartoum. And that was then I started thinking in planning, you know, to go out of the country, to go to a better place where I could continue my study, or work and live my life, because as I said, a refugee life in third world country is very tough. So the Lord opened the door for me to go to Sweden. So Sweden is my first country where I was welcomed, and I was granted asylum in the country. So living in Sweden as as an immigrant, it wasn't really easy. I was okay. I was I was I was able to speak English when I traveled to Sweden, when I went to Sweden and applied for an asylum, but Swedish was totally alien, totally language that I even never heard before. I've lived a life, as a ref first arrivee in Sweden. I was placed in a refugee shelter in the north. I was very, very far from the capital city. You don't have any choice. You just have to accept whatever the government offers you. So I was placed in the northern Sweden called Svappavaara. This is a very small community of a population of about 300 people living in that shelter, about 600 refugees from all over the country, the world, from Latin America, from Europe, Eastern Europe, Africa, Asians, you name it, all kinds of races and people from all corners of the world. And I end up living there. And I was there were some Ethiopians and Eritreans to begin with, but I wasn't welcomed by my own community because they immediately noticed that I was a believer. And they, as soon as they knew that I was a believer, they isolated me, or they kind of withdrew themselves away from me, because you know how it is in our community, in our country and in among our people, right? If you have a different belief system, then you are totally different. You're not. It's just us and them. There's a separation between us. So I was not welcomed, and I started feeling loneliness. And I was, I know, not in a sense of my faith and my relationship with the Lord, but you need to have a fellowship and a sense of community, belongingness, right? So that was missing, because I was kind of rejected by my own people. And I had some friends, like from Latin America, Eastern European people that were studying Swedish with me, but you really want to belong to your own people as well. So I started praying, Lord, here I am. I'm living a life here, and I before I left Sudan, I was praying, Lord, wherever you want to use me for your glory, I'm ready to go anywhere. So I was hoping that the Lord answered my prayer, and the Lord would take me to a place where I will be a blessing to other people. And that wasn't really happening because I was rejected. No one wanted to have anything to do with me.
So you mean there's about 300 refugee there? About 300 refugee.
Yeah, no more than that. 300, the population of that small town, small community, was 300 people.
And the refugee number?
Refugees number is double
Are you
the number.
serious?
Yes,
Yeah, and
because
out of that number of people, let's say about 600, there was
yes.
nobody that was very intimate with Jesus or a close relationship with God.
There were some, but there was none among my own people. There were about 30 Ethiopians and Eritreans, but none of them were even close to have a faith life at all.
Yeah, and there's that hate element
Oh
when they
yes.
know you're not with us, then
Exactly.
you're against us. And of
Yes.
course, yeah, no, I can understand that, yeah.
Yes, exactly. So that was the situation.
Well, you know what, Pastor? Time for break. We
Yes.
will be back right after.
Yes.
Do you love Ethiopian food? Then you're going to love a buyethiopiandishes.com, an online grocery store for all Ethiopian, Eritrean, and African food lovers. This online grocery store is filled with all the Ethiopian foods you love at affordable prices. Items are available in vegan and dairy-free. Kulet, wet, and injera come in spicy and non-spicy and can be delivered to your home in Toronto. Now you can cook or warm and eat your Ethiopian meal every day of the week in the comfort of your own home. Purchase your products online at buyethiopiandishes.com or stock up on your favorite items at a store near you. Just click on the link on the website that says retail locations and you'll find dozens of stores that carry kulet, wet, and injera. And if you want to pass on your love of Ethiopian food to family and friends, Abai also sells gift baskets, perfect for any gift-giving occasion. For more information, call 416- 918-5979. That's 416-918-5979.
Eden Mesganaw of RE/MAX Premier wants to wish all WDCX listeners a very happy 2019. And if this is the year you're looking to move, Eden wants you to know that she has home buyers in Mississauga, Brampton, and Toronto. You can reach her directly at 416-918-5979. 416-918-5979. Moving requires very good planning. Eden has been selling real estate in the GTA for 30 years. She knows the housing market like no one else. Let her experience, skill, and integrity assist you in making a smooth move in 2019. Whether you want a free market evaluation or to sell your property for the most money possible in a short period of time, Eden Mesganaw of RE/MAX Premier is who you need to work with. Make your appointment with her by calling 416-918-5979. 416-918-5979. When you do, don't forget to mention that you heard her ad on WDCX. Eden Mesganaw, your high-octane Christian real estate agent in the GTA.
Welcome back from our break. Without further ado, I'm going to hand this mic to Pastor to continue with his testimony.
Thank you very much. So I was talking about my life at a refugee shelter. And I wasn't really welcomed in my own community among my Eritrean and Ethiopian friends. So it was not really easy, though I, not really enjoyed, but I fully accepted me being like kind of persecuted for my faith in Christ. But at the same time, I expected that I will be fruitful in sharing the gospel, gaining some people to Christ. That wasn't happening, and it created some kind of discouragement in me. And I was wrestling with God. Lord, why did I come here? I told you that I wanted to be for your glory. I want to live my life for your glory, and nothing is happening here. And I was asking the Lord, so if I'm not really being used by you here, take me out of this place. I'm talking about a place where this place was situated about 300 kilometers above Arctic Circle.
Wow.
So cold and dark and isolated, far from nearby big city or town. So that wasn't really fun to be there.
Quick question, Pastor. Normally when refugees are brought to a country, I thought they should be close to all amenities so that they could adjust to a country. Mm. I mean, why you guys were put that far out?
Well, unfortunately, I can't really answer that question, because in those days in Sweden, I think, the community that I'm talking about, I was staying in, it was a kind of a mining community, and the mining business was going down and people were moving out. So there were empty places, empty apartments. Mm-hmm. So the government and the, immigration authorities, they wanted to use, the empty spaces, to place refugees in. So I think it was just, the availability of the place and so on. And also that they wanted to place people there, in different corners of the country. They don't want immigrants and refugees to be living in a concentrated one spot area in the country. I think that's what it was. However, as I was living there, the Lord answered my prayer in a very strange way. I was walking one day. It was very cold and a snowy day. It was in January, end of January kind of thing. And there was this elderly woman, an Eritrean, and I just bumped into her and she said hello and I said hello back. And she said, are you Habesha or an Eritrean or Ethiopian? I said, yes. And she said, oh, okay, so they sent you here. And I said, yeah. And she said, well, too bad, we're here suffering. We don't like this place. This is cold and dark and so on. And she said, she introduced herself and then she invited me to come to her house for a cup of tea. And I was really happy, to be honest with you. And I was very, very happy. And she told me where she resides. And right the next day after my Swedish class, I went to visit her and she welcomed me and she offered me tea and tea and some cookies, and we started talking. And I understood from our conversation that she had already heard about me from the other people in our community. And she started sharing some things and kind of showed an interest to know more about spiritual things. And then that was an open door. I was very happy, and I shared the gospel, what the gospel is, and about my life, what God did in my life, and so on. So she said, I really want to follow Christ. And I didn't even ask her, but she just fell on her knees, asked me to pray for her. I didn't expect that. It was just sudden. And I said, I was really surprised. God surprised me. Mm-hmm. And then I just walked closer to her and I laid my hand on her and I led her to Christ. So she was my first fruit in that place. And then I told her that, you know, she needed to grow in the Lord. At that point, I was 23. And then I kept on going every single day. And one day, I think at the third day or fourth day, some of my friends, you know, those who I was living with, Ethiopians, they came to visit her. And, and I immediately told them that, you know, we are reading the Bible, and is that okay if I continue? And they said, yeah, sure, continue. And that was another great opportunity for me to share Christ, and I did. And I started asking each and every one of them how they would respond to what they have heard. And all of them responded positively. Of course, none of them really said, you know, they wanted to follow Christ, but they were positive. And, you know how our people would respond, right? You know, respectfully, not offending, trying to offend me, even though they didn't really like me, but that was how it was. And for me, just getting that opportunity to share Christ was amazing. So among those people, there were about 30 in that community, refugees like myself from our country. So one after another, people started to respond positively and started following Christ. Mm-hmm. So what I would say is just, you know, it was a sudden church plant.
Wow.
And this is how I can put it, you know, suddenly a church fell into my hand to take care of. And I became, at age 23, I became quote unquote, a pastor. Simply, I didn't have any experience of church planting. I was active in my, serving the Lord in a church, but in a local church, but not in the sense of planting a church and running a church, leading a church. But I think that was my, the Lord was just training me for my future, my future ministry. And started teaching them to be, real disciples of Christ. Continued worshiping the Lord. All of them are new baby Christians. Mm-hmm. I was the only person who was more mature than everyone there. And I was teaching them and so on, and it continued. Most of us from that refugee shelter, we moved to a nearby city. We were placed in a city called Skellefteå in northern Sweden. And we continued the church, and more people started coming. Some more believers from Ethiopia started to join us. It became a church. Now there is an existing church around that area. It's quite after some time from that place to the capital city, to Stockholm. Mm-hmm. And I continued serving the Lord in a local church there, already planted church. And my spiritual journey continued from there on.
So the first place where you planted a church, or like you say, the church felt in your hand, does that church still exist?
In a way, yes. Mm-hmm. In that region, there is a church. And most of those people who came to Christ are still in that church serving the Lord. Mm-hmm. Some of them, they moved to the United States or other countries because they weren't really accepted by the Swedish authorities. But they are strong in their faith. They serve the Lord. There are some in Ohio, some in DC area, and others in other places in Sweden, in different cities, but all of them really going strong in their Christian life. So that's a huge blessing.
So that was everybody's scattered all over the place, yes. But they become the citizens of Christ.
Yes, amen. All of them are serving the Lord, and that's a huge blessing. Yes. That's a huge blessing. Yes. Yeah.
Well, I guess we're finishing the program with a win. Pastor left Sudan to go to Sweden, but then he didn't stop. He worked for God and he won soul. So I bless God for that. And we're finishing the program for today. Thank you so much for being with us. And we bless our Heavenly Father for this opportunity again. WDCX family, thank you so much for the opportunity. And looking forward to connect with you next week again at 8 p.m. Thank you.
Thanks for joining us on Overcoming Testimonies. Make sure to tune in next Saturday at 8 p.m. for more encouraging testimonies right here on WDCX.
Eden Mesganaw of RE/MAX Premier wants to wish all WDCX listeners a very happy 2019. And if this is the year you're looking to move, Eden wants you to know that she has home buyers in Mississauga, Brampton, and Toronto. You can reach her directly at 416-918-5979. 416-918-5979. Moving requires very good planning. Eden has been selling real estate in the GTA for 30 years. She knows the housing market like no one else. Let her experience, skill, and integrity assist you in making a smooth move in 2019. Whether you want a free market evaluation or to sell your property for the most money possible in a short period of time, Eden Mesganaw of RE/MAX Premier is who you need to work with. Make your appointment with her by calling 416-918-5979. 416-918-5979. When you do, don't forget to mention that you heard her ad on WDCX. Eden Mesganaw, your high-octane Christian real estate agent in the GTA.